Okay, back for turn four of the Battle of Soltsy scenario for roads to Leningrad. We're going to enter the 14 p.m. turn. So let's do a little bit of the normal things. Actually, I'm going to pull out the sequence of play sheet, because like I said, when you play alone, solo, sometimes you kind of, not necessarily cheat, but you just sort of move things around or things that aren't impacted. Such as like the weather roll, initiative roll, you can pretty much do those really any time. It's not like any other part of the turn influences that. So it's really okay to do that. Obviously, they have separate little parts here. Even though the first one is the weather phase, so we will start off with that. So let's see what kind of weather we're going to get for the 14 p.m. turn. It's most likely going to be clear. It could be cloudy. Oh, look at that. It's going to be cloudy. Rolled an 8. So cloudy essentially means that when we do air combat, you just add a +3 modifier. It's harder to get air combat to occur. So this is kind of a bad news for the Germans. They have more air power, but I think as we see in reinforcements, the Soviets will finally begin to have parity, at least in the number of air wings they can utilize on their turn, or in defense or attack, I should say. So the cloudy just makes it much tougher to get planes in the air and make them effective. So we'll see that happen in the turn. As you'll see, I'll kind of explain when I would have used a plane or when it's going to be harder to use planes. It's actually much more difficult in this game because the planes, as I think I mentioned last turn, have such low efficiency ratings that a +3 modifier is significant indeed. So we'll see how that actually goes for the turn. Okay, so the next thing we're going to do is I should be doing reinforcements, but I'm just going to do initiative so that we can see who's going to go first. Oh, I cannot believe this, man. We're getting some really interesting rolls in this game. So the Germans barely beat out the Soviets again to retain initiative. Okay, so let's take a look at reinforcements. Dun, 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 dun. For the 14 p.m. turn, I've sort of knocked some of these aside, pardon my messiness. You can see that row there, a lot more third motorized coming in, and the last bits of the 8th Panzer finally chugging along the road. And for the Soviets, we actually don't get that much. We only get those two planes at 14 p.m. and 15 a.m. So those are going to be, actually 15 a.m. is actually a nice reinforcement turn. But at 14 p.m. we only get these two planes. So let's go ahead and take these guys and put them in the ready box. And with these guys, we know they're going to come through the southern part. And we also get another bridging token. I haven't used these yet, and I probably need to be using them. But this is represents a bridging capability. I already have one, as the Germans and the Soviets have two. I haven't been using them, and I really should be, but I haven't. Mainly because to use one of these, you have to declare an assault turn, and then you have to pick a space within 4 hexes of an HQ, and then you can bridge that river or stream or whatever. But the assault turn thing is kind of what holds me back from using it, and but that might happen soon, because as we can see from the map, Germans had quite a successful turn last turn, so they were able to really take Soltsy, and now they'll be able to sort of get their defenses set before the 70th shows up. So anyway, that was a little bit of recap. If you watched the last turn, then you saw all that. Okay, so we got the weather, we did initiative, we're going to get the reinforcements placed, but since the Germans always come through one space, there's not a lot of decision making that goes on there. Okay, so da, 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 da. Okay, now is the big part, the supply status phase. As you can tell, we discussed last turn, that pesky 202 unit cut off supply. You can see he's on the road. He could have been even like a hex away and projected a zone of control on that hex and interrupted supply. It was kind of foolish of me not to set up a combat that would have either kept him from going that way. Like, for example, I was looking over, I could have probably brought over that armored car, maybe. And just sort of set him up there so that he could have kept the unit from going that direction, or if it had gone that way, to suffer an automatic step loss. I was being a little foolish and not thinking that way. So because he is sitting there, the following units are going to go out of supply. We're basically going to have, or go in emergency supply. This stack will go in emergency supply. This stack, and this stack. As a consequence, the artillery we had last round, I believe it's hiding in here. So as you can see, all that artillery still remains fired because at the end of the turn, you check to see if it's in supply. If it is, then it gets gets resupplied with ammunition. As you can see, this one is not. So because they're out of supply, or they're actually in emergency supply. So I sort of explained this last turn, and really emergency supply is just It's just like being in supply, only if you're found out of supply the next turn, then you end up being with out of supply for real. And that can cause all sorts of problems because out of supply greatly reduces your ER and your movement ability, and it also decreases your attack ability. So it's not like you want to be out of supply. You don't lose units like in other games being out of supply, but it's also not great, just like other games. So yeah, you don't lose anything, and it's not really worth it to necessarily spend a lot of effort to put guys out of supply if it's going to put you in a bad position. But if you can, and especially in this scenario where we're going to see increasing incursions on this little road over here, as you can see, the 183rd is already in position, and a much larger force will show up later. Who is that? The 180th. So this road can be cut more easily. And so as the German player, we're going to start thinking of not only defending Soltsy, but also creating a rapid reaction force to sort of go back and be able to deal with any kind of threats, like should have been dealt with here. So we'll go ahead and put emergency supply markers on these people. One thing I haven't been using the game comes with is sort of force group markers that you can use. So I have sort of big stacks going on here, and I could be using like really simple force markers, like this one's for the Kampfgruppe 1. And I have up to 5 of these force markers, so you can see there's 2. And I have them for both sides as well. I'm not using them in this game because then I'd have to keep referring back to the holding boxes. It's just easier when I'm showing everybody this game to have all my stacks out. So you can actually have your big stacks get put down to 1 token. That makes things a lot easier. Oh, I gotta get one more out of emergency supply. This guy's in emergency supply, and you may be asking, how is he in emergency supply? Well, if you remember the rules for supply, which I think I've only briefly talked about, you have to trace 7 hexes back to a supply road. And if it's a winter turn, it might be less. And if it goes through a marsh, it's less. If we get to those, we'll talk about it. But as you can see, this stack, and you can't like cross rivers. Like supply can't magically cross a stream or a river. It has to do so at a bridge. So if you remember, this road isn't connected here, so it doesn't get any supply from that main road. So this entire road is not good for any of the German player. So you can see here that I can't trace 7 hexes. I can go 1, 2 to that road, but this is blocked here. I can't cross this stream. If I go 1, 2, 3, there's nothing there. And go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You see, I just there's nowhere I can get to get supply. So, or do trace supply, I should say. So therefore, he's going to get emergency supply. Which I was sort of rambling. I forgot to get him a token. Hold on. Oh, there we go. Sorry, guys. I'm going to try to make these movies or videos recordings a little shorter. I've been making them pretty long, so I've been getting detailed. So I think this time I'm going to try experimenting with moving more of my guys and just and not really showing you all the movements, just really working towards getting the turns done faster. And actually, as we get through more of the scenario and the action centers around Soltsy, the turns actually go by a lot quicker because activation markers, it's really easy to know what you got to do. Either you're trapped or you can't move or you're making an attack. You're not planning necessarily your overland route and try to get the best, all your forces in the correct place. A lot of times they're already grouped together in such a place that those decisions are very small. So, okay, the Germans, since they want initiative, they will put all 4 of their markers in. That means, again, as the Soviets, we can only choose 5 markers. I think we're going to leave the 3rd tanks out again. We just don't need to remove the 3rd tanks. That's kind of sad, but the truth is, I'd much rather move these other forces. Maybe next turn we have the option of taking the activate any formation marker, and I'm definitely going to do that, so that can really help. Because then if we don't pick a marker, if we draw that one, we can still activate a formation that's not been put into the cup. And that's a very helpful ability, especially since the Soviets have, you know, 6 or 7 different formations running around the board. Okay, so I've done that. We did supply status. We did the initiative. All right, so let's see who's going to go first, and then we'll take a break and start the movement. Oh, I put them all in one cup. What is it? See, I'm talking and I'm doing dumb things. Like I put all my markers in one cup. Okay, got my German markers in a cup. Okay, and it's gonna be the 8th Panzer. So the 8th Panzer is gonna have its ability, or is gonna have its shot at sort of clearing this road again. Shouldn't be too hard, and then also preparing for the defenses of Soltsy. So let me think about what I'm gonna do here and come back. Okay, we're back looking at possible move for the 8th Panzer. You'll notice I've taken off the emergency supply markers off these stacks just so I can look at them, but it is that group and that group and that group and that group. They're in emergency supply. And what's putting them in emergency supply, if you remember,
is actually this unit right there. Sort of that 3, 4, 5 guy right there. So I've got to think of a way to get him off the road, and actually it's two units here if you take a look. It's a 5, 4, 5 and a 3, 4, 5. You know, it's not terribly crazy, that's just going to be 8 defense points, but it's enough that I need to think, how am I going to attack this unit so that I can destroy it, hopefully, and keep it from just retreating and becoming more of a nuisance, or maybe, for example, retreating and joining this group up here. So I've got to find a way to surround it, kill it, bring enough force that I can actually kill it or surround it so that when I make it retreat, because it is just leg infantry, I can surround it with some red box movement and inflict automatic step losses and hopefully just take this entire stack out. But, you know, I can do that pretty easily, but I don't want to divert too many forces to do so. I just want to use just enough to surround it and also make an attack, because the bigger threat looms up here with the 70th coming down the line. I'd much rather have my forces kind of deployed to deal with this threat, because it is big, it is looming, it will come down the pipeline. Not even just the 70th. If we look down here, we've got elements of the 21st Tanks kind of sneak over. There's these guys that sort of the leftovers from the turn before that I would love to take out, such as this last 3rd Tanks unit. It's weak, it's worth a point, I would love to get rid of it. This 202 unit's way down here, but if I could get rid of that, you know, any infantry I can get rid of, any steps I can get rid of, is going to be very helpful, because right now is where we're going to start feeling the pinch of Soviet pressure and Soviet units, and the numbers just growing and growing. The other thing I think we need to look at is, of course, thinking about these forces down here, the 183rd, and their ability to possibly cut this road again in several different places. And because it's already been cut up here once, if they're able to do this again and I can't reestablish supply, then all these stacks of units will become out of supply, which is quite annoying. So what I need to do is look, and I'm going to take a look here, and when I come back, we're going to have this attack planned out to take out the 202 unit there. And I think I'm going to try to reorganize my defenses around Soltsy, because honestly, I would like to get a unit that could build a strong point in here. Right now, I don't have a unit that can build a strong point. I mean, this is just my self-propelled anti-tank gun and some anti-air. This actually has some units, but it's mainly just artillery that can't fire, an anti-tank, and a tank unit. So I need to get some infantry, if I can, in there, some motorized infantry. If I had an engineering unit, that could also build strong points. So I need to kind of reorganize my defenses around Soltsy and begin really thinking about how this turn's going to go, because I am going first, but that also means that the German or the Soviets are just going to be able to slowly get their pieces down the line and be able to, you know, react to my movements, because I don't really want to pass right now. And if I did pass, the one advantage would be I could see what the Russians are going to do, but obviously I need to take advantage of this. My defenses aren't set, and I need to really open this road up before it gets even worse. So I'm going to take a break, I'm going to look at how I can do this, and when I come back, we'll actually launch that attack. So I've sat and thought about it, and I've come up with the plan I want to do for the 8th Panzer. As I sort of stated before, my goals are threefold, essentially. I want to get rid of this unit, hopefully eliminate the stack, but more importantly, push it off the road so that I can reestablish supply. I want to attack this armor unit down here, because it is flipped and weakened and is not being supported by anybody, and that's a free victory point if I can actually take it out. And I want to adjust my forces around Soltsy so that I can actually put better defenders in here, because the onslaught of the 70th is almost upon us, and also a northern attack from the 237th, and a possible incursion by the 183rd in the south. So there's the 183rd, as I was describing earlier. The 237 is up there, and the 70th is coming. Not to mention the 21st Tanks are there, as we looked at last time. So one thing I didn't show you off camera is I moved reinforcements. You can see here I got some more tanks coming in, which is great. 3 more tanks, need those. And then I also brought up this artillery unit, an army one. It's very powerful. I'm going to use it for the 8th Panzer. I could have given it to the 3rd Motorized, but I decided 8th Panzer probably had more pressing needs for it. So I'm going to be doing a little bit of jumbling of forces. It's going to be one of those fun moves where I'm moving stacks around all over the place, and I'm going to have to really be careful about labeling emergency supply, because some of these stacks are going to move, and of course, as we know, this stack is out of supply, or in emergency supply. So let's go ahead and start moving our guys into position. This is a fairly powerful stack. containing a couple motorized infantry and a recon unit. And what I'm going to have them do is go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They're going to hold up here. We're going to take this tank, these two tanks here, and they're going to go up the railroad 1, 2, and 3, and because I'm entering the zone of control. What else was I going to do? I'm also going to bring this guy up and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We'll bring him there. So it's going to give us, what, 3, 6, 8. And over here we have 15, so that's 23. And then I'm going to bring this guy over. So what we're going to do is we're going to bring this guy over, and then we're going to have to label everybody here as under that emergency supply, and that guy is not, because, or actually he is under emergency supply. What am I thinking? Oh no, he wasn't. He was a guy who came from down here. Yeah, sorry, that was confusing. Sorry about that. And then I also have an artillery unit I need to move somewhere. Not at being the risk of it just being totally hosed. And one, and well, let's see, I can't bring him up here. Right, 3, 6, 7, 8. Well, I think what we'll do is we'll bring, this is sort of not really a safe place for him. Let me think. That's where we'll put him. We'll bring him up here. Not the safest place, but I really don't want anybody from the 183rd coming up and sniping that artillery unit. Okay, so these guys are going to attack here. And what I need to do is I need... I left this gap open, but... Oh, I remember what I was going to do. I wasn't going to go there. I was going to go here. That's what I was going to do. There we go. Okay, that makes a lot more sense. Okay. So now we're going to talk about moving units to do Soltsy to defend that. So this stack has very high-powered units, and of course a spent guy. So we have Manstein and a couple motorized, and... What else do I have here? A fired artillery unit. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take... So let's focus on attacking this guy, because we're going to have to shift forces down to attack the tank. And that's how we're going to get things all together. So let's take a look. I'm going to be bringing none of those guys, because they're all weak. But I am going to bring this tank. He's going to go and 1, 2, 3... He's going to go there. I'm going to bring this self-propelled artillery unit and 1, 2, 3, 4 because I didn't use the road to go that hex, so I had to go here. So this counts as normal movement, no road movement. So I have 4 points right now. And then there is a guy hiding under here. There he is. He's going to go and 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's going to give us the ability to attack that guy. And then what that leaves us here in Soltsy is these three anti-air units for 3 points each. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring over my motorized infantry here. Let's go 1, 2, and 3, 4. So that's a super defensive hex now. This is good. Of course, they're all under emergency supply. This fired artillery, we're going to have to group all of our fired artillery together. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to pull that guy aside right there, and what we're going to do is we're going to put a bunch of our artillery here. So I've got these three stacks. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to go, boom, put that there. This artillery is going to come over to... heater. Just kind of leaving it unguarded. So how much points do I have there? 1, 2, 2, two, four, six, seven. All right, actually, I'm going to give them these guys too. I know, I should have been more careful about movement, but everybody can move there. I sort of double-checked that earlier. Everybody's in good movement ability. Okay, so there we go. Okay, perfect. So that was a lot of little movement around, but I think we're going to be able to accomplish our goals here. So let's go ahead and do our attacks. Let's start with this guy down here, the tank attack. So he can combat react. So let's see if he does that. He's got a beat of 4. He does not. There's no one who can react move, and he can't refuse combat, so now we just go to attack. He has no artillery. I'm not going to use artillery. I don't want to use air on this. It's cloudy, so air is going to be difficult to do anyway, so it's going to be just a straight-up attack. It's going to be a mobile attack, because we have a tank there. All right, so let's calculate what we got here. He has 2 defensive units. I believe I have 6. 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, so I've got 3-1 odds. We don't need to do a combat coordination check. We're not doing artillery, and we're not doing any air. Actually, he might try to throw air in, because he has air now, so we'll see if he actually gets his air. He's going to spend a... Oh, see, now he really can't, because it's cloudy. If you remember, these have an activation rating of 4, or an ER check of 4, and because the cloudy is a +3 DRM, +1 for mobile combat, he would have to use HQ points to get his air off the ground, so that's not going to work for him. So let's do the DRMs. Let's see, he's in rough. You can tell here, he is actually in rough terrain in a forest. So that gives rough terrain a +1 DRM on combat. So he has +1 for the rough. I'm going to be using my motorcycle guy as the lead unit, so that's a -3 in my favor. Let's go ahead and move this down. Okay, so it comes out to be a -2. All right, so we're going to roll -2. You know, let me double check that I did all that combat right. I haven't done this in a while. I haven't been filmed in a while, so let me just double check real quick. Cast, artillery, don't have to do a combat coordination. Oh, do I get a combined arms bonus? I don't think I do, but let's double check. Tank Force has an armored unit, it does, and it does have a motorcycle. And the defender cannot have red defense strength. No, he's good. So we actually get another -1 for combined arms bonus. So we get a -3 total. We're going to roll. Oh, that's good. So we got a 4, so that's a 1 result on a 3-1. This is good, good, good. Pretty sure this means this guy's dead. Yep. Defender 2 retreat. So he's toast. And we get a point. So I could advance after combat, but I don't really want to because that puts me a little closer to those guys. And I kind of like my position here. It's nice. So I think I'll stay there. All right, so let's do this attack. Let's see what we got here. He cannot do anything. He can't combat refuse because he doesn't have his HQ with him. He can't combat react if somebody can do that. And he can't do no retreat. Actually, that's what I mean. He can't do a no retreat because he has combat or doesn't have his HQ with him. And he can't combat refuse because he's not a red box movement. Okay, so let's calculate the attack. We know he's got 8 defense. So let's... And I'm attacking, I believe, a 24. I believe I just calculated that. So that's 15, I know that. 15, 16, 17, 20, 1, yeah, 24. So 24 to 8, that's also 3-1. Hold on one second. All right, sorry for that delay. So let's finish up what we're doing here. We have 3-1 attack. I won't be using air here because I don't want to spend command points on it. I want to spend that on my combat coordination roll because I'm going to need to do that because I have 2. I'm attacking from 2 hexes. I'm using mobile. So I'm not going to use air. The Soviet player is not going to use air because their chances of getting in are extremely low without using command points. So we don't have to do that. There is no artillery. I'm not going to be using my artillery because I already have 3-1 odds. He has no artillery. I'm going to do a combat coordination check. I'm going to use my armored car with a 7 rating as my lead unit. I am going to spend 2 points on this because I need this check to succeed. I really want to do a lot of damage. So it's a -1 total modifier because it's +1 for being mobile combat. 10. Well, that's unfortunate. So we automatically get a +2 to our roll because we failed our combat coordination. He doesn't get any defensive terrain bonus because he's just in clear. And I'm using this guy, so it's a -2 differential. And I'm also getting a combined arms bonus. So 1 CAB. So I actually get a minus. Sorry, guys. So we just get a total of -1. Yes, -1. And let's roll that. Doo-doo-doo. Oh man, we got an 8. So what is 8? 8 is... Oof, defender retreats with a red result. So we don't actually have to do armor attrition because he doesn't have anything to qualify for that. But he's going to have to retreat. So, what's the best place for him to go? Probably going to be here and then here. Okay, so he automatically loses a step for having gone through red box zone of control. And now we make an ER check to see if he loses another one. He does not. So he's very lucky. Okay, so yeah. That's the 8th Panzer turn. We got everything done. Got the goals accomplished. I would have liked to have gotten rid of that guy, but we did a step loss, and he's off the road. So we'll see who comes up next for the Soviets. And it is the 183rd. So when we come back, we'll take a look and see what the 183rd station down here is going to do. Let's see what the 183rd can do here. So the thing about the 183rd is it's sort of a banged up unit. It is, you can tell here that's just a regular old, get you a little closer there. That's just a regular old battalion. But as you can see here, if we get to the bottom of the stack, here is a double put together unit. It's just a banged up unit, so that's two like battalions put together. So it's slightly more powerful, but at the cost of having one less entire unit. So not really a great trade-off. But at the same time, it's infantry. That can be very helpful in this kind of rough terrain. And it is defense factors. They do carry at least 3. So this stack is still, yeah, a 9 defense factor stack. So, you know, that's nothing to sneeze at. It can be a nice, effective bump in the road for the Germans. Sometimes all you need is the Soviets to be a bump in the road. It sounds pretty inglorious when you put it that way, but that's just kind of how it is. So the main threat that the 183rd can present is it's not very strong offensively. It has fairly good defensive value. It's not amazing. But its main advantage is that it's in what we might call the soft underbelly of the Soltsy scenario, in the sense that they can sort of zoom up here and cut off the main supply road to that the Germans are relying on, because as the Germans sort of get stretched out further and further up here at Soltsy, they're going to have a longer and longer supply line to try to guard. This is just the first unit that's going to come in for the Soviets, the 183rd. The next one that comes in at 15 p.m. is the 180th, and it's actually is it a put-together unit? It's also slightly battered, but it's just more guys. But it won't be coming in for 2 turns. So my goal is to make a threat, to make a push, so that I can hopefully delay some forces here from zooming to the front, or even better, bring units from up there down to address the threat that the 183rd presents. Anything I can do to siphon forces away so that when the 70th comes and starts making its push on Soltsy, there'll be less of these armor units, less units in general, just trying to hold and defend that area. Because even a delaying action here is going to prove pull off a lot of dividends for me. So, thinking it over, I've decided on a couple things. I'm going to take the stack here, and I'm going to put them in this city here in Niemna. Yeah, is that Liemna? So bad with, like I said before, in English transliterations. We'll just call it Liemna.
And so the reason that is because if they're here, they can jump off on trails pretty easy to go get that road. So here's a better way to look at this, right? So I'm really thinking about this key stretch of road as something that can intercept pretty easily next turn. So I put these guys here, then they're able to jump off on this trail pretty easy and go 1.5, you know, 2, 3, and then they can kind of come up here, get closer here, and cut the road off there. I'm also going to put another group, I'm going to put this group unit, I'm going to put them up here, so they can jump over here and immediately cut that, and also cut anything up here. So, because of zone of control, obviously, they'll jump across here, and their zone of control interdicts that hex. It also gives them nice defensive terrain, because any attack across the stream is going to give them automatic +1. If I stay in this village, I get another +1. The rough here is a nice, also got a slope, one of the few areas on this map with a slope, which means they would have to use an assault combat if I was there. It doesn't let you cut the road, but it's a good fallback point. So yeah, this is a nice little area. It gives me a lot of great ability. If I could move twice in a turn, I could even put threat on killing that rocket unit or just really be a pain. But right now, I only get one move because I haven't gotten the activate any formation marker that the Soviets can get. And I think they're eligible for that next turn, yeah, at 15 a.m. So we'll start being more of a threat then. So this is going to be kind of a slow move turn. We're going to go, let's see, and 1, 2. This guy's going to go and this actually costs 2 for non-motorized enter because it is a marsh. Let me see if the woods add +1 to that. Yeah, so it does. Yeah, so that's actually 3 movement for me to get into. So it's and, yeah. Actually be 1, 4, because I'm not using that road all the way. So it'd be 1. And then 3 to get there. So that's 4. So that's actually almost, that's the most I can go. Anyway. So as you can see, if I put my guys there, oh yeah, and we'll bring the artillery up, and he's actually going to go and 1, and 2. He's going to go there, because I want to, if we end up crossing this river, this guy only has 4, but I want to be kind of close. I mean, his range lets him bombard all this, but I want to kind of keep him out of the way too. Okay, so there's 1A3rd. Not easily reached by these units. Again, like this tank unit is only 9 points of strength, so it's not going to be able to make really good effective attacks here. So this is now a new threat the Soviets or the Germans are going to have to figure out a way to counter or at least prepare for. And that's what we want to do as 1A3rd, is make them think, make them worry. That's kind of the goal. Just so you can see a little board. I don't think I ever do really like huge shots of the board, so that's kind of what we're talking about with Soltsy and the units coming down. Okay, so let's take a look at who's going to come up next for the Germans. Eighth Panzer, 1-6. Eighth Panzer. Oh, you know, iPhone does not want to focus all the time. Eighth Panzer's coming up next, so let's look again and see what we want to do around Soltsy. Giving the situation of the Eighth Panzer some thought, I had to deliberate whether I wanted to do an assault turn, which we have not done yet in this playthrough. I find I'm not doing a lot of assault turns right now, mainly because I've one of the primary advantages of assault turns is that you can use units not of your formation that's active in assault attacks if they're adjacent to an enemy target. That's one of the main advantages of assault. You can also build strong points during an assault turn. That's the other main advantage. And in this game, actually, you can use assault turns to build bridging units. You can use it to cross a stream or a river. You have to use an assault turn to be able to build that. So there are advantages to using it. It's just I haven't had, as the German player, a lot of incentive to use the assault because, of course, you only get half your movement. And right now I've been kind of moving at a breakneck pace. To get Soltsy to do overruns and whatnot. And this turn would have been a good candidate, I should say, to do an assault turn because I had moved in motorized infantry into this city hex of Soltsy, and they can build strong points. And the defense in that hex would be so much so that I don't really think the Soviets could mount a very good attack. And if you don't attack a unit that's building a strong point, then at the end of the turn, that strong point's completed. So if a unit's building a strong point and then you go attack that unit, that strong point is considered null. It no longer is being built. It's out. You have to begin again the next turn or with the next activation, if that's possible for your formation. So, you know, I thought about doing that, but the truth is that I just have some little nagging issues I want to take care of. Mainly this 202 unit that we repulsed last time from the road. I really just want to kind of take care of it. And one of the other things I really had a big debate about was what I should do about this 183rd problem. Okay. Because if we kind of look at what the 183rd can do here, let's zoom in a little bit. So next turn, if they move in here, they're cutting the road. Like, he can just move here in the city, get some nice defensive terrain, and he's cutting the road, and it's going to be difficult to attack him with so many streams and difficult for me to access. He can also use these units to come up here and cut the road at different places over here. It'll be really easy for him to slip across the river and then just begin moving over here to cut the road. And the only thing I have over here to deal with that, really, in terms of the 8th Panzer, is those tanks. You know, it's just three tanks I've got here. I mean, it's not attack factors. It's just not a lot, though, considering that each of these stacks here that the 183rd is rolling with is 9 defense factors themselves. So I'd be getting, like, 1-to-1 odds. I would not be able to get a shift, really, with even this artillery, should I be able to activate it, or this rocket unit. It just wouldn't be enough, really, to deal with it. And all of the 8th Panzer units are on the board. No more will come through reinforcements. So if I'm going to be dealing with the 183rd with 8th Panzer units, I need to kind of think about what units I'm not going to be devoting to the defense of Soltsy, and which ones can become sort of my fast response units. So I was thinking maybe I would divert forces this turn and maybe divert some of these motorized infantry and maybe a tank and start moving back. But the thing is, I'm going to push my luck because the 183rd is not going to activate again this turn. And because, as I've mentioned many times, the Soviets don't have an activate any formation marker, I'm not really worried about them being able to cut the road again and thus create a situation where all these stacks that were emergency supplied go out of supply. If they did that, that would be pretty much an incredible Soviet victory. And it kind of makes me think that, like, I really should have probably been more aggressive with the 183rd's move. Pardon me. I should have been more aggressive with the 183rd moving them and trying to cut the road again, because it would have forced me to take units away from this engagement here to deal with the threat. I mean, as it is now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these, when it comes to the reinforcements, I'm just going to take those tanks and I'm going to move them to Sitnia, because that way they're at least close. If the road gets cut here, they're close to respond. If the road gets cut here, they're close. They can pretty much do anything they need to along this, you know, a very limited access, which is what the only available movement these units can really undertake. I might surprise myself, I always do, but I think Sitnia is a good sort of defensive point for this. As part of the core of the reaction group that's going to try to keep this road open as more and more units from the Soviets begin to pile into this area. So we don't even really need to count that. I know it's easily doable, so we'll just move them there. Okay. We'll go ahead and try to activate this artillery unit. So because it's not within 4 hexes of an HQ, I'm going to have to roll and try to see if I can get its efficiency check. So let's see if I can do that. Oh, nice. A 5. So I'm going to be able to move it, and what I'm going to do is I'm just going to move it up here with the tanks. Yeah, it can hold out. And they're not going to move again, so this is good. This is nice. It's a nice little defensive token in case some sort of shenanigans happen next turn where I don't get a chance to react and they go first. It'll be nice to have. Okay. So, yeah, probably should have been more aggressive with the 183rd, but, you know, that's how it goes. So now, what are my main goals? Well, last turn, I was able to reshuffle the defenses here. I mean, saying last turn, I mean the last activation. I was able to reshuffle the defenses here in Soltsy, and I'm pretty happy with it because this hex is just loaded with defense. This is very weak, but I think I'm going to be able to reinforce it with some of these units. And this is a stack that's got all the used or spent artillery in it, and it is a little vulnerable, but I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to drive away this unit, hopefully, or kill it, and in doing so, provide some zone of control coverage that units up here that you can't see, because I need to zoom out, so that sort of units up here won't be able to slip down on their activations and sort of make strikes at that stack. I'm going to try to make it as difficult as possible so it's not an easy target. Okay, so I'll start executing those moves. It's not going to take too long. I've kind of thought about it, so here we go. The main thing we're going to do is we're going to attack this unit, and then what we're going to do is we're going to take these guys. And they're all red box, of course, and they all have at least 6 movement. I think they all have 6 exactly. And what we're going to do is we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Because it's 1 and plus 1. So 5 total movement to go there.
We're going to take this entire stack, which is full of, it's got some two tanks and two armored cars. And what they're going to do is going to go one, two, and three, four, right? So what I've done is I've sort of created that sort of pincer movement here. So even if we retreat, it's going to take a step loss because it's surrounded by red box infantry or red box movement people, and it does not have red box movement. Now, in order to keep it, so you remember last turn I attacked, and then it retreated, and then it got on the road, and that is what caused this whole predicament in the first place. So what I'm also going to do is I'm going to take this motorcycle infantry, and what he's going to do is go one and two and three and four. He's going to hang out there. And that way, if I do cause a retreat, this unit can't just come down here and block the road again. It's gonna have to either, it can't go that way, basically, because the motorcycle infantry is projecting zone of control here, you know, all around. And so that's just sort of a safeguard there. Then we'll take this guy, and we're going to just move him next to the stack of spent artillery, because there's already 9 points there. So I'm going to go one, two, and three. I'm feeling like that's a pretty safe spot for that. It's, you know, it's kind of in the open, but I'm going to deal with it. And then I'm going to take these guys, and I think they're just going to fortify the stack, because really all it is all the old, not old, just injured step loss armor I've taken here. And so they both can easily make that, and it's also another piece of armor, so we're just going to bolster that defense there. Technically, this hex is the victory hex for Soltsy, so that's kind of the key one to hold. Okay, so that's the 8th Panzer's move, and now we're just going to do mobile combat here. So let's get a little closer, just so we can... Okay. So let's go through our combat here. First off, there's really not much they can do because they're leg infantry and there's no red box people around them, so nobody can combat react for them. They cannot combat refuse because they're leg infantry. And they cannot declare no retreat because they're not in a strong point, a town, and they don't have their HQ or NKVD unit with them. So they're sort of stuck in this battle. It's going to be a mobile battle. So there's no artillery to speak of because I'm not going to use my artillery as the Germans. I'm actually going to save it in case I get counterattacked. Not likely, but it might happen. So the Soviets have no artillery to use. We could do close air support here. I think the truth is I'm not going to use it. I'm not going to use it as the Germans. And again, the Soviets really can't use it. The truth is they just can't use it because they'd have to use like a 5. Because remember the whole like plus 3 because it's cloudy, plus 1 because it's mobile. So even with a 5, they have to roll a 1. So it's not likely without any HQ command help that you're going to be able to get close air support off. So we're not even going to do planes. That leaves us with a coordination check. It is mobile. We are attacking from more than one hex, so we are going to have to do a coordination check. I will make... let's make this guy the lead unit. He's out of supply, but I think I'm going to be able to get it right back in supply next turn. If not, I'll try to remember that. He's on emergency supply. He's not even out of supply. I keep saying that. In this game, it has just emergency supply, which is sort of an interesting concept in its own right. Okay, so we got 7. I can use HQ points because I have an HQ over there, and I think I will because I do just want this attack to go off swimmingly. Last time we kind of failed our roll. Hopefully this time we won't. So because this guy's within 4 hexes, we can use that. So the modifier is -1 because, again, +1 for being in a mobile turn, -2 for the command points. We just got to get... 7 or less. Look at that. A 7 minus 1 is 6, so we pass. We get our combat coordination. And so now we do the final odds total. So we're going against 6 points there. I've already looked. It's, you also have to take my word for it. And I believe we have 24 to 6. Let me double check here. So I know this tank has 18, because it's 6, 12, the recon unit makes R15, 15. And this tank has 2 tanks, 3, 6, And then another 3, so that's 9. So 9 plus 15 is 24. Okay. As he knocks some guys around. Okay. So it's 4 to 1. If you look at the defensive thing, I believe he has no defensive terrain bonus. Nope, it's clear. I get an ER of... Actually, he's not going to use the 4. He's going to use this 5 unit. Which is another reason I want to get it, because that's a 5-4-5. That's a pesky and good unit. So let's get rid of it while it's in the open. So I'm going to get a minus 2 for ER. Let's go ahead and put that up here. I get a combined arms bonus. Okay, so it's a minus 3.
So on 4 to 1 odds, minus 3 roll.
Oh, pretty much going to be dead, I'm positive. Yeah. Defender 3 retreat. So that actually kills everybody. Okay, perfect. That was actually really great. That's exactly what I wanted to do. I wish I could have done it the first time. I saved myself a little bit of effort. And here's something I can do that's going to be really nice. I'm actually going to go 1, 2, because it's a mobile combat, and I could advance everybody's red box, and they're not the prohibited units, so I can advance 2. And because I'm doing that, I'm actually going to be able to get a plus 1 on my modifier for my initiative next turn, because every time that you advance it more than one hex because of combat, you get a modifier on your initiative roll for next turn. So I get in better position here to screen my artillery, my spent artillery in here, but I also get a plus 1 modifier, so that's really great. So, you know, not too bad. 8th Panzer didn't really fortify the position, but they did get aggressive, pushed back some units, resecured the road, good for you guys, and also took out some units. So, I mean, not wholly bad. Pretty happy with that. Okay. Hopefully the road stays open. I believe it will. I don't really see a threat, but again, I always surprise myself, even in solo play. I think that's kind of weird, but it happens. Okay, so, who's up on the Soviet side? Oh, the 237, so that's going to be these guys up here. Oops, don't put that back in the cup. Alright, so here's where we start getting some good options, and we have to really think about what we want to do with a 237, because just like the 183rd down here, we have the opportunity to put, not necessarily cut supply, but put pressure on this unit and create a pocket effect as a 70 sort of, if we get that kind of diagonal view going on here, you can kind of see they're coming in this way. And so that's the main value of these units, is they can begin to put pressure here. And honestly, they can cut this road sort of where this motorcycle infantry is. That's what I did my last game. They came out here and cut this road. And so it is possible for them to cut supply. So we're really going to think about where we want to position them here, because they can be kind of killed. They're just infantry. I mean, they're very good infantry. They're not like the 183rd. This actually is, I believe, a fully put together unit. I don't believe there's any... you know, sort of two battalions put together to make a one battalion. I think it's a fully constituted unit with some good artillery here. We got a 6, we got a 4. So yeah, the 237 is a good unit. But the other problem is, of course, is that when you don't see off frames, they're dealing with the 3rd motorized up there. And the 3rd motorized has not gone yet, and we have other units coming in for the 3rd motorized over here. And then also reinforcements down here. So, interesting. In my last game, I didn't really put a lot of pressure up here by the 3rd Motorized. I mean, I did, but they mainly came down to the south and dealt with the problems in the south. And that was so effective. Here, they're clearly outgunned to the north, but just because they're even there, they're going to keep this force, I believe, from putting a lot of pressure down here on a potential pocketing of Soltsy. So, you know, that's going to be one of the more interesting aspects of this game and how it's turning out. Anyway, I'm rambling some. I'm trying not to do that again on this, but I kind of enjoy it, and I'm sorry if the videos are long and people, you know, wish they were more succinct. I'm just having a good time playing, and I'm having a good time thinking and talking it out, so I'm hoping that appeals to people. If not, you know, I'm really sorry, but maybe my style is not for you. But anyway, you know, I'm rambling. So let me think what I'm going to do for the 237. This is obviously a night turn. I may do this in the morning, so let me think, and we'll go from there.
Okay, so now we're looking at possible actions for the 237th. As I sort of detailed at the end of my last little bit there, sorry, it's been a couple hours since I recorded last video, so for me it's been a while, but for you it's been instantaneous. I mentioned the 237 is actually a fully complete unit in a lot of ways. It actually has more complete battalions. The one thing I probably didn't mention though, and I was looking at it as I'm looking at what I want to do with them now off camera, or as I looked at what I wanted to do with them off camera. One thing I noticed, of course, is they have very low efficiency ratings. They have 4 here. Meaning that when they attack German units, they're probably going to be taking negative die roll modifiers, or I should say positive die roll modifiers. It's negative for them, but it's a positive. You know what I'm talking about. The only exception to this is the fact that this unit has a recon unit, and it has a 6 efficiency rating. It's also the only unit in the entire formation that has red box movement. So you have to kind of remember that when you're moving it, because it's not a leg infantry guy, but it also has the advantage of having a higher efficiency rating. So when you battle actually units of German quality, it's more parity and less of a disadvantage. So, you know, honestly, I was trying to think what I want to do with these guys, and my initial thought was, you know, maybe I'll try to do what I did last game and see what I can do by bringing my forces down here and try to punishing, you know, the rear of the 8th Panzer here. The only problem is, of course, like I mentioned in my last video, is that the 3rd Motorized, you know, is not in force up there, but it's definitely enough to be worrisome. There is, of course, a reduced motorized there, a full-strength guy there, that's 9 points. Red box movement, of course, so they can zip around if I don't stop them. And there's more on the way. So there's those guys, and there's even more down here to be brought in. And the reason we have to think about that is because the 3rd Motorized is still up. There's still 2 activation markers. In fact, it's the only 2 left for the Germans. So we really need to be cautious about what we do with the 237 up here, because while I would like to take the bulk of my forces, which is here, these 2 stacks actually, and just start launching attacks to the south and harassing the 8th Panzer, which I could probably successfully do, I need to be careful, because not only would I be essentially leaving this as a weakly defended area by taking these 2 stacks away, there'd be a huge gap here to run through. This hex here, which is guarded by the 3rd Tanks, is not well defended. And the problem, of course, is that by not gaining initiative over the last few turns, the Soviets could not put in all their activation markers. So the 3rd Tanks has been left out the last few turns, and it's beginning to hurt us here, because this is an HQ unit. It's vulnerable. If we look at the stack up here, we see that there's a reduced 3rd Tank motorized infantry there. I would like to move that guy out and put this guy in instead and have 12 defense points there instead of 10, and also have just better attack capability. But I can't, because I don't have the 3rd Tank's activation marker. So I need to not only worry about, you know, 3rd Motorized getting active and moving around, but also protecting the 3rd Tank's HQ. Because these guys, if you look at it here, these guys here can easily use trails and get pretty close. They can get to here, I believe, or even here. So they have 2 activations. They can easily be up there and be attacking the next turn. So I think what I need to do is just fortify this area up here, and that way the 3rd Motorized has to double down and has to commit to this front. It can't just sort of slip around and help the 8th Panzer. I'm going to try to bring enough force to bear and guard this that I'm going to try to get an attack on this. And the reason is that this is a one, you know, probably one of the few opportunities I'm going to be able to have to do damage on a 3rd Motorized unit when it's not just fully stacked. Because if we take a look here, it's got an HQ, but it has a reduced guy there, right? And that guy. So 10 points total defense. There is artillery here that could help out. But I'm thinking I can gather enough forces with the 237 here that I can make a 3-to-1 attack on that unit. So let's actually try to see if we can make that happen. Let's do some moves here. So first off, I'm going to take this guy, and he's actually going to go back up the 3rd Tank's position down here and help reinforce it. So he's going to go and 1, and 2, and 3. This gives them, I believe, 10 points of defense, so that should be enough to hold off everything but the most concentrated attacks by the 3rd Motorized. And then we're going to take these guys, and this is just a 12-12 stack, and we're going to go, let's see, how do I want to do this? One, two, three. Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go one, two, three, four, because it gets stopped by the zone of control. These guys are going to cross. That's one, two, and three, four, because of that. So the added bonus of this attack, of course, is that we've cut off supply now to this unit. Because there's actually a stream there, you can't really see it, so it can't trace supply across an unbridged stream. This is the only hex, and it can't go through here. So technically, it is cut off from supply right now. Next turn, or at the end of the turn, when we do checks, or the beginning, I guess, when we check for supply, it will go to emergency supply. So it's going to have to do something. It's going to have to make a move, basically. And then finally, we'll take these guys, and we'll go and one, and two. And we'll just hang out in Utragosh. Because they have artillery that can reach these hexes. Make sure about that. One, two, three, four, five. Yeah. It can reach that hex. And, oh, that guy can't reach that hex, but that's okay. He can defend, though. He has range of four, one, two, three, four, so he can defend that hex, which is pretty much the main one I want to defend. I don't want this to get to fall, because then they can just have access to the road. So yeah, this is going to set up, so we've defended this point. We also have reinforced the rear in case they break through, and this is not a particularly strong defensive stack, but it's good enough. It's got artillery there. I'm not going to use engineering unit and HQ. Alright, so let's total up our... let's look at this attack. So, the other thing, of course, is that this has to be an assault attack, because the Soviets up here have no armor car, no armor at all. This is the one disadvantage to this unit, is that it has a recon unit, but it has no armor car. It's not very mobile. It's very much a leg infantry unit, which is sort of the bulk of the Soviet army, at this point, at least in the war. Okay, so let's do our attack here. So we know we're fighting 10 defensive points. Let's go ahead and do that here. And what am I attacking with? Let's find out. So I got 12 points here. This is my monster stack. It's three of those guys, so it's 15, 16. And then I have only 8 points that can attack here. And the reason is that even though it's an assault combat, I had to do this during a mobile turn, so this guy can't participate, that third tanks guy can't participate. If it was just an assault turn where I got half MA, then I could use that guy in my attack, but he won't be able to participate this turn. So let's see, we've got 12, we have 16, that's 28, and 8 more is... was that 36? All right, so that's the initial odds right now. Third motorized could run away. And honestly, it might try to react. It's going to try to react and move out of here. Let's double check we can do that, because I'd rather not face an attack, even though a 3-to-1 attack is not great for the Soviets, because they'll suffer damage 40% of the time. I'd rather not trade units with them, because I'd rather just have my units stay intact, and I'd rather have the advantage of deciding when I attack. Okay, so we're going to do combat refusal. All units must have red box MA. They do. And they're not disrupted. So let's do an ER check on the lead unit, and that's going to have to be that guy. It's got 6. So let's do an ER check on that. Nope. So he's going to stay in battle. Okay. And because I did that, I can't do a no retreat declaration. Kind of a bummer, but that's the way it goes. Okay. So he's going to stick around. First thing we do is say, hey, is there any artillery? Well, yeah, there is artillery, and we're going to use it. So let's, and we're going to use our HQ points on this artillery check. So it's a -2, +1, so we get a -1 because it's +1 for being immobile, -2 for the command points we use there, so we get a -1 total to our roll. All right, a 3 passes. So his defense now goes to 13. We decide if we're going to do any close air support. I think just because the Germans or the Soviets have a lot of planes, we're going to go ahead and try to test our luck here and bring one of these guys in, and the Germans will as well. So they're going to have to roll ones here. You got to roll a 1 to get this plane. No, both rolled 4s. So that's not going to work. And now we do combat coordination. So because it's an assault, let's double check on what we have to do here. Nope, we're not disrupted, and we're all in the same formation, so we don't have to do a combat coordination check. So now we just calculate our DRMs. The defensive terrain is nothing.
He's going to use that 6th unit as his lead unit. I'm going to use this guy as my lead unit, so there's no ER differential. And I don't get any combined arms bonus. So this is a straight-up roll. It is a... what is that? See, that really helped him out there. So now it's just 2-1. This is going to be a much riskier attack for me. All right, a 6. This might be in that sweet spot where we get some attrition. Let's find out. A 2-1 result with a 6. Yeah, that's an attacker 1, defender 1. The sad thing is I lose my sweet, sweet recon guy. Because he was just a 1-step unit, and that kind of does hurt me. Not terribly so, but it hurts. I mean, he was a zero stacking unit, which is huge. He's gone, but more importantly is I did some attrition here. So this unit was the lead unit, he flips. Doesn't lose a lot, just 1 point, but it's still big for me. And, let's actually see. Oh, and it was an armor attrition result, so we're going to have to, definitely going to roll to see if we lose our planes, but let me double check if I have to lose victory points for losing a step. Nope. Only armor artillery HQ units have cost me victory points. Okay. So that doesn't cause me to lose victory points. I did just lose a unit, and we have to do ER checks for these guys because of armor attrition, so we'll go ahead and roll that. Oh, they both pass. That's pretty good. So they're flown, and that is the 237th's action. Okay, so now we know, of course, since we did that, that the next German action is going to be third motorized. Okay. So let's go ahead and take a look at what third motorized is going to do. Let's move you guys. Let's actually get in closer where these guys are at. So you can see this is sort of where the furthermost element is of the third motorized, and of course those guys up there. So I need to figure out where to move this guy, and I need to move the reserves. So let me take a break and think about what I want to do there, because I don't want to just ponder a lot and waste time on the camera. So I'll be right back. I've gone ahead and moved the third motorized reinforcements that were coming in this turn up the road, because they weren't really going to be able to do anything this turn anyway, so I just went ahead and moved them out, showing you. But just to give you a sense of what they got for reinforcements, they got a nice battalion of artillery, another motorized infantry, and then 2 motorcycle infantry. Very nice, high efficiency rating, high movement units. So I'll be looking forward to getting them into the battle. They also have the added bonus of maybe just having this road, but again, I'm not going to use 3rd motorized to help repulse the 183rd. I'm going to use the 8th Panzer. Here they are. They're coming up the road. And they may actually go up a little further and cut up later on the line. I haven't decided. That leaves the big question of what I want to do with this guy. So the thing about this stack that makes it so very vital is that it's just normally a bunch of really powerful motorized infantry, but it also contains, ta-da, that guy, a zero stacking tank. He is the probably most valuable unit in the third motorized, if not maybe in this game, because he gives the third motorized the ability to do mobile attacks. Otherwise they have to do only assault attacks because they have only motorized infantry. That one tank allows them to do mobile attacks, and as we see, we're going to definitely need that for some of the plans I have to use here. So let's take a look at the situation. Let's get a little closer. So let's get like the weirdest angle possible, and let's take a look. Okay. So the issue facing me here is that these guys are surrounding me, they're cutting me off from supply, and they're fairly powerful, and I can't really just maneuver around them because I have to cross a stream and enter woods here, so that'd be 1, 2, 3, 4 movement just to go here. So I'm not really going to be able to motor my way around here. But at the same time, I need to break this line up, and I think I can do it because my other units that are coming up the trails, I think they're going to be able to get close enough. So here's what I'm going to do. These guys actually aren't going to move, which sounds crazy. They're just going to stay there and chill. I might think about where I put this guy. I might think about that. We'll come back to him in a second. But what I'm really going to worry about doing is I'm going to get this guy... I'm going to get this stack into the game. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move up the trails, and my eventual goal is, because I have one more activation, is to get to here and then be able to come up here and overrun this stack at 3-2 odds, which is not going to be great, but I think with the ER modifiers and some other things I'm going to get, I have a good shot at least getting a retreat result. And then knocking this stack out of the way, and then using this stack, and then the new, and then where this stack will come, it will overrun, using these two guys here to attack here, or maybe there, I haven't decided. But whatever seems to be the best. But the idea is that they don't have any more activations, I still have another one, so let's take advantage of my high mobility, and let's use some overrun and attacks to our advantage, because we finally have our magical tank unit. Okay, so here's how we're going to do this. We're going to go and one, and one, and, so it's two and, three and, four, and five, and actually he can go one more, six. Yeah, they're all six movements. That's even better. It gives me a little bit more maneuverability. Okay. And that's what the third motorized is going to do. That's pretty much their entire action, because now the next turn I've set myself up to overrun this stack. And we'll see what happens. I really kind of thought about overrunning this stack, but it's in the woods, and woods gives you plus two. And honestly, I'd rather just do damage to the high-powered stack here, and that's their high-powered stack, offensive-wise. It's a 15. It's still a 12 defensively, but it's a 15 offensively. So something I really want to try to target and take out if I can. Okay. Who's up? The 70th. If it was somebody else, I could probably do their moves pretty quickly, but the 70th is of pretty big importance because, of course, their job is going to be bringing the pressure and the pain. You can see there, there's the forces. Their job is going to be trying to put more pressure on Soltsy, and because they're probably going to be the ones that can most directly eject this, the Germans from there, because they also have armored car, as we can see there. I think they have another armored car somewhere else, and they have some powerful 6-5 units and a lot of them. So they can actually do mobile attacks as well, even though Soltsy itself is a town, so you have to use assaults when you're attacking a town. But since the Germans haven't been able to build strong points, you know, we can have some degree of ability to attack. But again, it's pretty well defended. I've had a lot of time as the 8th Panzer to reinforce my line there and shift my guys around, so it's more defended than it was. And I really need to consider what the 70 is going to do. So again, I'm going to take a break. I'm going to take a look at what I need to do with these guys, and when we come back, it'll be the 70th. So here's a view of the 70th, and what their primary objective is going to be kind of getting around Soltsy. They have a couple of concerns. They need to not leave this road open, because that'll lead all the way back up to Shimsk. And there's three very tasty victory hexes back there that could be easily gotten if a German unit were to slip by. So one thing we need to do is sort of begin an action where we're pushing this way, because I'd like to be able to get around, or at least put pressure on the top and the side. But without doing so much that I leave the road too weak, or these too weak, because this can obviously just be counterattacked by different forces. Now, hopefully, as the turn goes on, or next turn, when the 183rd makes its move, we'll see some of these German forces have been forced to being redeployed. So like this, maybe some of this will have to leave. Kind of definitely hoping for something there, because right now Soltsy is well defended, and even though the 70th is perhaps the most... No, it's not perhaps. It is the most powerful force the Soviets, most powerful formation the Soviets can muster. It's good. They alone, will be insufficient to tackle what is already in Soltsy right now. It's going to be difficult to dislodge them. Nonetheless, I am going to try to make some moves that are going to give me some, hopefully, protection from overruns, because I definitely don't want to suffer the fate of what I think the 237 is about to undergo when the third motorized activates next. But keeping that future catastrophe aside, let's go ahead and start moving our units here at the 70th. Now, the 70th is a lot more capable formation, has more powerful infantry units, more of them. It also has an armored car, and under here
It has one of those awesome tanks under zero. So it can conduct mobile attacks, and it also has quite a bit of artillery. We have a 6 power artillery here, a 4 one there. There's a 4 defense anti-tank gun. So a very capable formation. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these guys and I'm just going to essentially start creating what I can do is like a ring around this hex here of Soltsy. What I'm going to try to do is get guys all the way around it, hopefully 3 hexes around, and just do concentrated attacks on that town hex and hopefully wear down the defenders there. I can play a little bit of a game of attrition. It's not a huge deal, but I don't want to be throwing away units on impregnable defenses. Hopefully something I get a good break. Either I get rid of units or something happens and I can start slipping behind and doing more damage. I wish I could get to this artillery stack, but it's just not enough. These are leg infantry. It's going to be difficult enough even getting them close to units, much less outmaneuvering them and getting in the back. So let's go ahead and take this stack because it's right here. And what we're going to do is we're going to move it up to right here, I think. So we're going to go and 1, 2, 3. Yeah, so we can do that. Actually, it's going to be 4, right? So we have, was it right there? Or was it right there? Yeah, it was right there. And 1, and 2, and 3, 4. Yep, that works. It's got a little hair on it. I have 2 dogs. Border Collie Shepherd mixes, so they shed prodigiously. And so you'll see that on the board, because I've left it out for a little while. Okay, so we got that unit there. This guy is going to come down and go, this stack here is going to go 1, 2, and then enter here and stop. And it's going to stay in this marsh because a marsh not only makes him less susceptible to enemy artillery fire, artillery that fires on a unit in a marsh hex is halved. Artillery that fires out of it's not halved. It's just the fact that artillery shells are hitting a marsh and not necessarily a forest or ground and shrapnel and all those effects. It's less effective. So we're going to come down and go 1, 2, and then he's basically going to hang out here. That's 1, 2. Because we're entering on a trail through there, it'd be just another 1, so it's 3. So we're going to hang out there. I couldn't go here if I wanted, because that would be 3.5, 4.5 for getting there. So this is as far as he can go. Or they can go. He is, if it's one person. Okay, these guys are going to come down. What they're going to do is slip across here. That's 2 movement, 1, 2, and that's 3, and they're going to hang out in this marsh there. That leaves this guy here. He's going to come down. That's 1.5 because 1 for entering trail and other. Or I'm sorry, that's actually going to be 2. 1 for crossing the stream, 1 for entering trail and other. 2 and 3 and 4. We'll put in there. And that helps kind of block the road a little bit. Hopefully the Soviets get activation or get initiative and get the 70th in action pretty quickly. That would be really handy and helpful. More hair. Sorry, guys. It's annoying to me. All right. And then what we'll do is this is the HQ unit. It's got the tank, and it has that engineering unit. That's actually very handy for assaulting the town. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to take what's under here, artillery and anti-tank. I think for now we're going to group the artillery where this unit is. So it's going to be and 1, and 2, 3. And the reason we're going to do that is because that infantry unit's going to be there. So we got 2, 4, 7, and then here we can put that guy 8, 9. So this will kind of be the super stack until I can get that infantry unit out. It'll protect the artillery there. And then what I can do is... Yes, and SOV, and 1, and 2. Yeah, we'll take this engineering unit, and he's going to come join the stack here. And so will this tank. Yeah, so it's going to be able to make it, so it'll come down there and do that. The HQ will hang out there. Oh, so I got the armored car, too. Armored car, you know, the thing is I don't use my armored cars probably effectively as I should. It really needs to be a unit that goes and harasses infantry or is a supply cutter. So I really probably should be maneuvering it in a place where it can get in the game, so to speak.
I think that's just going to have to be up here. So what we're going to do is we're going to go and one, and two, and three, and four, five, six, and should just keep it there. No, we're going to do an and seven. That might leave him susceptible to an attack, but I really don't think so. This way he can maybe launch on the trails and come across here, which would be kind of nice, because maybe we can get a little road cut, which would be big if we get opportunity shows itself. Okay, so that was the 70th. So let's go ahead and get a little sort of what we got going on there. That's the scene of Soltsy. So, of course, the last German activation is going to be the third motorized. There we go. That action is going on up here. We can probably get a little closer. Just a little bit closer. All right, so here, I've also got to move these guys in the back. And one thing I forgot to mention is I forgot to move that guy earlier, the Arco. He had some artillery, and he should have moved, actually, with the third motorized last time. I noticed that. I went ahead and moved him, and that's kind of where he's at. So here's my thoughts on this turn. We're going to get the reserves up as fast as we can in a second. I'll probably do that when I take a break. But the initial idea is to take this guy, and he's going to go 1, 2, overrun this guy. So that's 3, 4, because you have to do plus 1 for overrun. If I get that successfully, there is a bridge here, which I don't know if you can see. There you go. There's a bridge there. I can overrun this hex as well, because I've only spent 4 movement. That'll be 5 to get in the hex, plus 1 to get there. That's 6 total, so it's a potential I could overrun 2 different groups of units. And what I have here is I have, let's see, I have 5, yeah, I have 16, 18 points of attack, and each of these guys has 12, 4, 8, 12, actually this has less, so it only has 10. But with 18 to 12, that's good enough for 3 to 2 odds. And given that I have ER bonuses and other things, I think I'm going to have a fairly good chance of overrun. I'm actually going to look at it. I'm going to take a break first and then make sure I got the odds right in my head. But that's sort of my plan there, and then we'll see where I can attack from there. And I got to move these reinforcements up. So let me think about what I want to do, and then we'll come back and actually do those attacks. So I originally had these grandiose plans of doing overruns I just described to you moments ago, maybe doing one here and there. I can do the first one, that's no problem, that can easily happen. The problem occurs that the rule of overrun says that you can't conduct an overrun from a hex in multiple enemy zones of control. If it was just one enemy zone of control, like if I had overrun this guy and there was just this stack here, I could overrun that stack. In fact, I would have to, I couldn't just move anywhere else, I'd have to keep overrunning. If you overrun a unit and then end up in enemy zone of control, you can't just keep moving. You have to use your movement to overrun, or you have to stop moving. But because there's a guy here and here, if I overrun this hex, I can't keep overrunning because it's from a hex in multiple enemy zones of control. That's okay. My original plan was, before I thought I could do two, was to overrun this hex and then use an attack from both these guys to attack there. Or maybe there. I hadn't decided yet. Because this guy could sort of run around. It'd be difficult for him to do it. He could kind of try to cut stuff off. I don't think it's really going to happen, though. I moved my reserves up, or the guys, not the reserves, just the reinforcements that were coming up. So we won't, they're really not important now. They won't factor in this battle. I do need to move this Arco. I need to move my HQ artillery unit up. That would probably be a big deal. Unfortunately, there's just not super safe spaces for it. And I'm a little afraid to lose it. Ugh. Dang, I really should have probably not moved him there. I might actually pull back, although I would get 7 points on the attack. That would actually kind of be really helpful, wouldn't it? Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to We're going to take a chance. This is probably going to hurt me. Remove this guy here. You can't. You barely see him off camera. Zoom that. There he is. So you can see I moved that Arco unit here. He's definitely very vulnerable, but hopefully this does not bite me in the butt, but it probably will. I just can't think of a space, and I might want to use... Does he have the range to even get there? He has a 5 and a 5. It'd be 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, he could reach that hex with those, so... Probably going to stick with that and be okay with that. Okay. So now let's do our actual move. So, because everybody here has 6 movement, and they're all red box, and they're all together in one stack, we're going to go 1, 2, and overrun that hex. So the way it works is... He gets no ability to react because this is just movement and doesn't even get to use combat coordination. He has no artillery he can summon. So it's 12 points. I have 18. Yeah, I've got this is my 18 stack. And so it's 3 to 2. 18 to 12 is 1.5, or 18 to 12 is, yeah, 3 to 2 odds. So lead unit, he's going to use that guy, his 5. My lead unit's not going to be my tank. It's going to have to be one of my motorized infantry, so we'll go ahead and pull them on the top. So I get a minus 1 ER bonus. So let's get these odds here right on the board. 3 to 2, minus 1 ER. I get minus 1 combined arms bonus. And there's no terrain defense for this guy. He's in the clear. So I get a minus 2 to my roll. I have an 80% chance of making this attack happen. So let's see. All right, this is good. Got a 4. So minus 2 on a 3 to 2 combat. A 2 is a defender 1 retreat. Okay, that's big for us. So this guy loses a step. Now because we did the overrun, we get to choose the way he retreats and he gets disrupted. So we have, and I have to use certain rules though. I can't force him to go through a zone, like an enemy zone of control, if there's a better way out. And there is. So he's going to go 1, 2. Actually, we'll just go ahead and keep him here. Put him in there, 2. Actually, we'll just go here. Keep him on the road and help him block Utrecht. And he also gets a disruption marker. Let me see if I can find one of those. Okay. Where are you? Disrupted. Okay. So now that we did that, I can advance. And now we're going to attack here using mobile combat. He can't run away. He doesn't have his leader, so he can't do no retreat. He has nobody with red box movement to help him out. So he's stuck there. We are attacking through a bridge, so we don't get the negative penalty for going across a stream. We'll get to that in a second, I guess. So, we know he has 12 defense. There's no artillery. I could use artillery, but let's actually figure out what we got here. So we got 12. I know I have 18 there. How much do I have in this stack? Oh yeah, 8, because they're all reduced. So I have, what is that, 26? Could I get that to 36? I don't think I could. Yeah, I can only get, I can't get it up. So it's going to be 2-1, a 2-1 attack on mobile. Can he use air? Does he have any air to get through in? He is going to throw in some air. I guess we will try to do the same. So we have both our 5 units here. He actually will use, he's got an HQ point. He will use his HQ point to try to use the air here. So he can roll a 2, I have to roll a 1. We both fail. Alright, I'm not going to use artillery, so I'm going to use artillery. Now we're going to do combat coordination checks. Because we are mobile, we're attacking from more than one hex, so we have to do a combat coordination check. Again, this guy will be my lead unit, and I actually will use my 2 points here, because I want this check to succeed. Alright, so we got to beat, let's see, so minus 1, because it's plus 1 for being immobile, minus 2 for command points. Oof, I don't get it, I get an 8.
So let's do the final battle odds. We get plus two for combat coordination failure. I believe his ER is all four. Oh, actually, he's not that. He's not a 12. He's a 10 unit. I forgot, because I got underneath him. He's part of the third tanks. So actually, I will try to send this artillery in. So we'll go ahead and call in this artillery. We'll use this guy, his point for it. So I have to roll five or less. I do not get that. In fact, I actually roll a 10, luckily, since... Oh, actually, a 10 is going to make zero. That's a total whiff, because I used the Arco point here, but it was already a plus one due to the mobile combat, so that negated my die roll modifiers. If you roll a 10, it's a complete whiff of your artillery. So, yeah, that kind of sucks. So we're still stuck with 26-10 here. Now the plus two combat coordination, I have minus two ER and minus one combined arms bonus. So we get a minus one total modifier. We're going to roll. All right, we got a five or a six, but it becomes a five. Five on a 2-1 combat. Mobile is defender retreats. He's going to go one, two. He's going to just take that. And what we'll do is we'll actually advance him there. So not quite as much damage as I wanted to do. I actually did want to inflict a step loss, but that's okay. I mean, it's still pretty good. Didn't have to do any armor checks or anything, so these units fly and they're done. Does kind of leave this guy hanging in the back, but he is... I believe cut off from supply now himself. Oh golly, I guess I really should have moved these guys because now he's still cut off our supply. If he hangs out there. Although technically he doesn't because we can go one, two. Hold on a second. Can we get to here? So we got one, two, three, four, five. So, yeah, so we're still in supply, because I can trace over this way, and that unit's good. So I'm not going to worry about that. He's fine. Okay, so that's a third motorized, and now there's only two possible Soviet formations I could activate. We get the 202. That's actually only one unit left on the board, and it is way down here. All by his lonesome. He's just going to run away. In fact, we're going to send him down to Volot. Because he's good for almost nothing. So, and one, and two, and three, and four, and five. And as you can see, Volot is over there. It is actually a victory hex. I should mark that. So we'll keep him there. That means the very last one will be the 21st tanks. So let me take a break and think what I'm going to do with them, and then we'll have the end of the turn and do all those fun things. So very quickly, thinking of what I want to do with the 21st tanks. So I have some of my units down here. I have a motorized, I have another just regular infantry, and then I have a tank underneath there. Yeah, a very powerful tank. And I have artillery and another tank there. Here I have a tank, another great tank, and a motorized infantry, all red box movement. I think what I want to do is have these guys come down and sort of become the lower cut force. Like, they're going to come play along this road and then eventually sort of decide if I want to have them, you know, come up here and take this, or if I want to have them come up this way and then threaten to cut up here and potentially use their bridging units, get across this quicker, and become more of a threat this way. Because they do have some mobility, they have some power and punch. And the main reason is because if you're a fan of the NBA, then you know all about spacing, right? Spacing is all about the league, and you don't want to clog up the lane, or else you kind of restrict your ability of your point guards or your other guard play to drive in, or your center to do fancy things, or your forward and whatnot. You know, spacing is what it's all about. And just to use that basketball metaphor or simile or analogy, I'm actually talking off the cuff here. We don't want to clog this lane up here. I don't want to bring a bunch of guys up here and clog this road, because really this river sort of dictates it's really hard to get across it for motorized units or for red box units. It takes a lot of movement for other units to cross it. And so it sort of really restricts what you can do here. And if you attack across it, you lose half of your attack factors. So you don't want to bring a ton of units up here So I don't necessarily want to bring in my 21st Tanks guys that I was going to use the Southern Road. I don't want to bring them up here to do anything. But at the same time, I don't want my tanks getting in the way here of my infantry, because it's going to be, it's difficult to coordinate your movement unless you use a combined formation, which I could try to do. And honestly, a 70th 21st Tank combined formation would be pretty potent. But, you know, at the same time, I want to have flexibility, and I don't want to be relying on getting a combined formation. I want my plans to say that'd be great if I could do it, but if not, I want to have clear executable plans, and my plan right now is to have the 70s sort of surround this unit. So I think what I'm going to do with the 21st Tanks is sort of snake them up here, and they're going to kind of become this force that can dip down over here and provide some attack power and potency in the back and make a rear threat. So they're actually in the perfect place to do this, because it's and, one and, two and, three, and can I actually can't go there, four. This is a very tempting target for the Germans to go for. Two nice tank units, but it's also got kind of a motorized infantry, so it's got some defense, and it's all red box. They can react, move, and do some other things if they need to on the fly. Hopefully next turn, then he can use some more of his movement to come down here and strike at the back, and not necessarily just make it all a frontal attack here. If we look at these guys, see what I'd like for them to do. I say with these tanks, they're kind of slow, right? So we got four movement, and one, and two, and three. I think we'll just go here and go four. And the reason I'm doing that is because I kind of want to get access to these little roads here and get up here. That's what I want to do. So if we look at this guy up here, he's got four and five, so we'll go and one, and two, and three, and four, and five, so we'll put him there. Sorry, it's a little off camera there. See if I can get a little height boost to get a look at it. So that's 21st Tanks, and so we're going to see if they can actually get their act together. Next turn, I plan on it being a little more exciting, because I'll be able to get my activate any formation marker, and that will allow me to actually do some double moves with people, which is really exciting for the Soviets. They've been had opportunities where they could do some severe damage had they had the ability to activate twice, and it just hasn't happened yet, but next turn it probably will. Okay, so that's the end of this turn. Let's go ahead and do an overview of the board. As you can see, the Germans are still pretty engaged in Soltsy. We've got the 183rd down here that's coming in, trying to do some road cuts. We're definitely up to siphon some forces off here to deal with that. The 3rd Motorized is slowly slogging its way up here and engaging with the, what is it, the 237th? Some disruptions, some overruns, but still no major breakthrough. And then the 70th has begun to spring its trap along with the 21st Tanks, leaving this back door sort of open, but we're hoping some reinforcements and maybe some timely attacks will force the Germans on the back foot. So that's the kind of, and also we were able to clear the supply route for the Germans here, so these units will go back to being in full supply. Maybe an opportunity wasted by not getting too aggressive over here with the 183rd, but so it goes. If we take a look over at our reinforcements, next turn for, 15 a.m., we get these guys for the 3rd Motorized, which is going to be some nice armored cars, another recon unit. Sorry, it's not all organized, spiffy. We have our optional reinforcements here, including a leader token and the activate any formation marker. It will cost 5 VPs. I think it's totally worth it. And we'll get what's left of the 202. Not much of it's left, actually, just one infantry unit. So, going to be interesting. Okay, also I should say the next turn marks the end of the first part of the scenario, in the sense that the Germans could have achieved victory if they had so many victory points. I don't believe we're going to have that. So as I thought, this game will go all the way to the full 10 turns. Okay, I'm going to do my little upkeep off camera, and then we'll start next turn and begin the 15 a.m. turn 5.